Let's see if this is working. Okay. Should be working. Should be live. My apologies. Hey, it's working. Right then. Better tweet out which one I'm using. Right then. Tweet. Hello everyone! Okay, right then. I am very, very sorry. You can see me and hear me. Okay. Well, you see, the thing is, I tried to set up a new fancy system. It's my own fault. I set up a new system. Yep. So, I do apologize for this. I will have a go again. This one at least is working with the fancy system live, so that's an improvement, but as you'll know, it was supposed to be on another thing, so I don't know what's going on. I honestly don't. I'm going to have to sort this out. Just sending a link to the most important person. Right then. My clock is an entire hour late. Which clock is running an entire hour late? Please don't tell me there's a clock somewhere on this I haven't spotted. I really should do something quite nice for you. Which is, I've got something to go along while I'm just doing my general talking. And if I press play on that. Right then. So, today is drills and bloody battles. So today is going to be quite cool. Today, especially if it works, is going to be very, very cool. So, I do apologize for the weirdness at the beginning. I also need to report a sad, sad thing. I am currently down to merely 8 litres of iron brew in the house. This could be a sincere problem. You're getting some audio feedback. I have no idea why there's audio feedback going on, but hopefully not. Hopefully there shouldn't be an high-pitched noise, but it is saying high CPU usage detected. Thank you, Soda Cult. Thank you, Gordon Collins, Jay Richardson, Brock Payne. Thank you, everyone. I do know Mr. Richardson was here first earlier. Perry Roden, yes, it's 8 litres. It's terrible. You know, I have merely got another 7 cans for the stream. Okay. So, there is still going to be some stuff I'm going to have to work out, obviously, for this, to get it to work right. Hopefully, I will do. By the way, the video in this corner, still getting used to this idea, there. That's just an automatic video. You don't have to worry about keeping up to pace with that. That's just going to be flicking through. When I start posting the pictures, they will appear here, in front of me. So don't worry, there are pictures to come. So you don't have to worry about the ones in the corner. They are literally for your amusement, because each of the files I've selected has about 150 to 200 pictures in them. And in a nicest way, that would mean if I was working through every picture of those files, we would be here for the next 6 hours. Whereas if I put them on an auto loop with a few seconds for each one, if you want to go back later... Yes, hi Richard, hi Stephen, hello everyone. Again, I'm sorry. Still some troubles with the visual audio input, but very interesting. The webcam is fun. The poor computer, my poor computer, has had the last 5 years of me writing my life on it, and a book and all sorts of things now. So it is a very lovely Dell, but it is now reaching the end of the road. So it's going to have to keep me going for about another year or so yet, probably. But the poor girl does require a lot more love and attention. She gets a lot of hard work. Hi, Carl. We have a fury kitten here. So I am quite enjoying my chats and these things, because the amount of different animals. There is an otter. There is a kitten. There are several dogs. It's fun. Hello, Carl. Hello, Mason. There is a lovely Dell. I worked my way through my bachelor's being a Dell technician at my university, fixing computers for them. And, the Dells were lovely. They earned my undying love, because whenever I opened one up on the inside, everything was nice and organized. Whereas every time I opened up an HP or a Mac, the CPU and the hard drive and the power pack were almost always on top of each other. And that led to all sorts of fun. So, Dells were the way to go. Also, quick book recommendation. If you haven't ever read it, this is very good. It's a nice book. It's good to read and it's fun to look at. The images on the top right, Do not worry about. I do always back up all my files. Stephen, don't worry. The Marmite comment won't get you blacklisted. Yet. The images on the top right are just flicking through. Basically, the idea is that the main presentation will be in this screen. But I could have either had a wall of just the message, just the rest, or I could give you this. So I gave it to you. I thought it was quite fun. Hi, Shlepi42. Yes, it's working now. This book doesn't have Alaskans. This has actually, authentic to history, the third of the R-class battlecruiser sisters. And I was actually quite surprised. When I first picked this up, it mentioned an HMS Reliant. And I went, there was never an HMS Reliant. And then I read, oh, it's HMS Renown and Repulse's sister. Okay. That wasn't going to happen. So I actually went and looked up online. And just as with Courageous, Glorious, and Furious, ordered as a free, so were Renown and Repulse, and Reliant. Reliant is never built. So it's really kind of interesting, what would happen if a Reliant was built and the Royal Navy had another battlecruiser in the interwar periods, and another battlecruiser going into World War II? Would that have meant they would have cut it? What would happen? It's quite interesting. It's a nice kind of actual. Hello, Pager. Hello again. I pre-ordered your book for a crazy $90. Oof. Didn't realize it had got that much. They keep putting up the price on me. The Red Bridge is the fourth bridge. And that was chosen because we wanted the one of the few places where they all based, and they all did some time serving out of the 4th and that sort of estuary. So even though the three classes never met, they never served together in terms of their whole thing. The battle class served with the Darings and the battle class served with the Tribals, but the Tribals and the Darings never met. It was a nice place to link them all together. Michael, I rose. I'm glad you like them. I will see in 99. I thought the third renown was meant to be HMS Resistance. No, it was HMS Reliant. The Royal Navy isn't... There was an idea of resistance, but no. As a rule, the Royal Navy don't like it as an idea. It might be resistant to them. Ooh. Mason Stewart, I prefer an aircraft carrier to an extra battle cruiser, honestly, if I was HMS Prince of Wales. But that's another thing, another time we'll get into. So. The Stila, oh, Norway shows so many things. I honestly think we could do a special just discussing Norway. I think we could have a whole time going into Norway and all the different joys of Norway. Jeff Beeler, HMS Resistance was the 6th R-class battleship cancelled altogether. Yeah, a battleship is far more likely to be called Resistance than anything else. They were used to moving. Drac did just do one on Norway. I know, he did an excellent one on Norway, and I've done a couple of videos on Norway, but it's one of those topics where, well, as you all know, bilge pumps is coming out soon. What you don't know is that sort of about 30 to 40 minutes before we start actually recording bilge pumps, the three of us sit there having a chat over Skype. And basically, imagine the Grand Tour, but imagine three naval historians filling those roles. And that's what the conversation is like. And anyway, Norway does come up, and we have fun with Norway. We also have fun with Norway in my Discord. I think there's currently a debate going on there about the ability of Norway. Anyway, so my plan today, originally I was going to work through every single exercise and just do them quickly. And I decided that was going to be... It came out in 1929. So how they decided to organize all the exercises and the 1929 exercises. So these are the critical ones, and then if you've enjoyed discussions of exercises, I will do another exercises one further along down the way where I'll discuss them with you. Steppy 42, as long as you don't try to build a tribal out of a Toyota Hilux or something stupid. We hadn't thought of using a Toyota Hilux. I think we were planning on a Land Rover Defender, but a Toyota Hilux could be viable. Interesting. Is the we'll see 99? Is the War Games rulebook available as a PDF? No, it's not. But I am tweeting out some of the pictures of the ones I'm going to use, and I will put them into the Patreon, and I'll sort of stick them up there. It's quite good. It's quite an interesting one. So, without much further ado. You're going to watch my love face disappear. Hello! So, now, this is always a fun thing to do. The tactical engagements, the sort of the exercises and how they're bringing this about. Actually, I think that might need to get bigger, so just bear with me a second. I'm disappearing completely. Can you see me? So, the objectives of tactical exercises are the critical ones. It's really the most important section. It's how do you work out what you're going to do. And the interesting thing with the tactical exercises is to exercise officers circumstances that will allow them to make decisions. Basically, all of this book is about designing how to fight wars and how to develop wars. Force A1, Dr. Philip Weir's thesis, Colour Some into War Excellence. Dr. Philip Weir's thesis is an excellent read. It's one of the reasons why, even though I've done a lot of work on exercise over the years, I have held off on actually doing anything properly on it, because I don't want to step into his area, and he's a very good historian and a very nice guy. However, if he continues not to do anything for much longer, I'm gonna actually step in there and do something. So this is basically me going to Phil, come on, write something, write it, publish it, we want to read it, it's good. I know, the font is very difficult to read, I do admit, I'm having fun with latency issues and still getting them ready. But what is interesting about this is that what they're looking at for a war is how they're looking at how these exercises are going to do. And very much the exercises are structured around training, not just for battle, but for war. There are going to be war-like scenarios. There are going to be scenarios where they're coming in, where they're going to be looking at convoys, where they're going to be different operations. And these are critical. Right. So. Now, I'm going to go through all of this one, and I've got several pictures lined up, so I can do that with them all. Hello. Another one's coming. Now, this one, charts are not showing up helpfully, and it's been more than helpful by the fact that my printer hasn't worked. But the interesting thing I want you to think about here is the speeds. The full speeds allowed for various classes are given in half-yearly returns of war vessels and aircraft. And basically, for exercises to be realistic, they are trying to make out how to try and justify and expand the areas they can use. The easiest way to expand the space of a fixed area you've got exercising is to actually slow the ships down. So, how do I put this? If you slow a ship down, say, in speed being 30 or 40 knots, it's 15 knots, you've suddenly doubled your equivalent area. Yes, everyone knows it could really go faster, but you've taken an area you've allocated for your exercise and you've basically doubled it, which allows things to go slower but also allows you to watch things more. It's good for the strategic layer of training. For the tactical layer though, what they actually do is they slow down the big ships and they speed up the relative speeds of the little ships so that they're attacking even faster. So they make it, the big ships have to think even more. Shepard 42, out of interest, has anyone tried recreating a Battle of Jutland using those rules? Yes, they have. And I have a feeling Battle of Jutland went interesting. It was pretty accurate. But more interesting was they've tried recreating the Battle of Matapan with it. And that went pretty much to plan. Pretty much. I see Jeff Beale. I see even Argus operates on the battle line. Yes, Argus. Time for me to disappear again. I've gone. Now, the interesting thing that comes in is that from the 1929 exercise, not only are aircraft being written in fully, they actually have navigation of aircraft as a critical area. And they have assessment of damage by aircraft, by machine guns, by all sorts of systems starting to be built in. So, they are basically building, for want of a word,
Hello.
They are building in as close battle scenario as they can. The procedure during the exercise is sort of quite interesting for how they're going to deal with unlocked gunfire, but pretty much it's more complicated than just rolling dice, which is what some people once told me. I once had an interesting debate with someone over this one. Right. And by the way, I am taking suggestions on the layout, so if you would like me to change things around or do things, I will be taking suggestions and trying to work on them. Right then. So, the thing you have to remember about these exercises is they are pretty darn complicated in getting their rules and working out their right. The British want to be very accurate. And one of the interesting things going on here is actually they are downplaying and minimizing the potential damage of torpedoes. They're doing this by changing round the factors. Now, there is a reason for this. They are actually making it look like they're making their destroyers exercise at a disadvantage. So for the destroyers to be successful in an exercise, they have to work harder. They have to work a lot better. And if they're going to do that, then that makes life easier. And it's this whole system is about building up the level of the layers the Royal Navy thinks it's going to need to attack. A better microphone might be nice on previous streams was clearer. On previous streams, I have been using my phone. Literally, on previous streams, this has been the screen. And as you can see, there's a picture of my mum and my previous dog in that photo. And literally, I've had that screen going with all the messages. So, that's fun. The British destroyers were so OP, they were nerfed by their own governments in war games. Yes, Baynard. That's from anyone I have. Yes, pretty much. To try and force their destroyers to be even better, the Royal Navy actually start at a disadvantage. And in war games, destroyers' torpedoes were rated almost as half the effect worked out compared to submarines and aircraft torpedoes. So the destroyer crews, to score as many hits, had to manage to launch twice as many torpedoes. Or they had to get closer. Basically, the idea for the Royal Navy destroyer crews was if they were launching the torpedoes from too far away, you know, they had to be very, very correct, sure they were going to hit. Otherwise, get as close as they could. And then, as Jay Richardson pointed out, I thought you said earlier that the capital ships were speed restricted, but destroyers are not so much. Yeah. The thing is, they allowed the destroyers to go faster to train the battleships to deal with destroyer attacks, but to compensate for destroyers being able to go faster, they then reduced their capability of their primary weapon system. So you're balancing these things. You're doing it to get as close to a real war scenario as it's thought to be. It's thought to be that under war, with a lot of firing coming at them, that destroyers are going to be suffering more casualties, they're going to be sustaining more hits. Therefore, they have to be doubly sure they're going to hit their targets. But it's also thought that battleships versus destroyers are in a high-speed engagement, especially if they're against Italian or Japanese destroyers, which were usually far more orientated around high speed, less orientated about seakeeping, then they were going to be dealing with far faster units. So this was about training the fleet for fighting, for a war. Jeff Beeler, interesting. Each battleship and cruiser carries a fighter. They do. And this was the key part of it. For, and by the way, everything's coming out on @AC_Navy History. All these pictures are coming out on that. So you can get them. And they should actually be all out by now, because they were supposed to start at 6 o'clock. And I had them all been out by 55. So, you know, they're all on there. The idea was that all these were carrying their own fighters. And fighters were considered the best things for battleships and cruisers to carry. You might carry a spotter aircraft, and you might carry a fighter as well, and they'd all be seaplane fighters, and they would launch to provide air defense of the fleet. Yeah, this is the service which isn't keen on aircraft. They're sticking fighters and reconnaissance aircraft on every single one of their cruisers and battleships at this point in 1929. The thing is, the Royal Navy is quickly learning in 1929 just the sheer limitations, thanks to these exercises, of these fighters. Well, your phone is sort of one. Your phone's frozen up to task of streaming, your laptop seems not. Choppy audio and video. That's annoying. You see, the thing is, it allows me to do better pictures for you and to do this thing where I've got that screen going and I've got the chat going and I've got everything else working properly, but it's not working on the rest. I don't know. I'm going to have to work on this one. I really am. And they definitely, I can see the pictures behind me over there have gone down quality wise. Yeah, I'm going to have to work on this. I'm going to have to get a better camera for starters, I swear. And, yeah, sort out things. Steamwhite. Note the USN practicing refueling sea a lot pre-war. Also logistics transfer to the sea. Did the IRON do something similar? Yes, they were. And in fact, from 1936, they're building the Dale-class tankers. Literally, they start building the Royal Fleet Auxiliary. Thank you, Turning 343. Jeff Beeler, actually, those fighters in the 1920s were mostly one-seaters, fairy flycatchers. Right then. So, next slide. One of the interesting things that always interested me when I was looking for this is the way the damage control shit is organized. Now, if you can see that, you look at the very thing they're concerned at is what effect is any damage going. Yeah, I do keep getting warnings, by the way, about high CPU usage, so I'm not sure what's going on. It is very intense laptop. I don't know. Poor old laptop. Definitely. Very impressive air operations by Courageous. 80 landings and no accidents. This is the things the Royal Navy was getting up to in these exercises. This is what they were critical about. And this chip gives you an idea of what they were thinking, what they were getting through with, because they were very much looking at how the effect would be on the whole fleet. You see, if your major unit is damaged, if it's slowed down, it slows down your whole force. They work on this. This is, of course, what they do to the Italians that gets the victory at Matapan. This is what they do to Bismarck. This is what they do pretty much every battle. The Royal Navy's idea is to slow the enemy down, then entrap it at will, and then destroy it. That is their plan. That is how they operate. It's quite a good plan. Stephanie Wilson, no, I don't have anything running in the background. This is the first time I've used this software live properly under fire. It worked okay in the test, but it's having a bit of a panic attack in the thing. It might be running the video as well and having the pictures stockpiled. It might be all that combined. Appears to be my processor lagging up, turning 3-4-3. Also one, is W torpedoes referring to W gear fitted on destroyers for pattern running torpedoes? Yes, it is. Jeff Ealer, I like the emphasis on reconnaissance and realizing its limitations, the need to be overcome. Well, here's an interesting thing. Okay, so the first phrase I should have started off with discussing, but I was distracted by all the IT issues, is strategic. Okay, when we talk about it, strategic thinking, all these things, that's the common phrase. But in the 1920s and 30s, the Royal Navy had this phrase of strategical and strategically. And these were the way they're thinking. So there was a slightly different phraseology. There's also, this is the period where reconnaissance starts to come in. But previous to that, the Royal Navy had occasionally, and still does in some papers after this, have the phrase recog. Definition difference being that reconnaissance was we reckon the enemies over there, recognizance being we reckon what enemies over there. So they have different things. Have I checked what's running in services? Yes, actually. I've got it sitting in my corner. Let me just check again. Check if anything is having fun. Ooh. Not much. No, it's mostly it's the XSplit broadcaster, which is proving quite massive at the moment. Yep. Oh, it's the XSplit broadcaster. I'm going to have to work on this one. But it's... allow me to show off the pictures today. I think probably... if I do... that... and that... yeah, that's cut down the processing lag a bit. I was trying to be too fancy for my own good here. I do apologize. That one's been done. Right then. Yeah, basically I had decided to go a little bit too far on my fun stuff. Probably if I remove that. That might make it a little better as well. Oh, right. And thank you to everyone who's done super chat and all those things over the last couple of weeks and those things and those who've become patrons and everything. Well, I remember, and those who actually sit through the adverts. I do know some of mine are becoming fairly advert heavy. I'm going to have a word with YouTube over this, but it's one of those scenarios where I am was relying on them because I'm not sure how to deal with it and what I need to do, and I was relying on them being helpful. Hi Ian, hello everyone. So thank you to everyone who signed up for those. In cast, seems whatever you did on Courageous, you had to be Commander of Glorious to progress up the RN management managerial ladder during the 30s. Actually, Furious does pretty well. Furious has Henderson, Lumley Lister, all sorts of officers go through Furious. So, Furious, Courageous, Glorious. Honestly, it depends. The trick is, are you deployed to the Mediterranean usually? That's usually more the experience of you will get promoted. Blue Banner has gone, Gordon. I hope the adverts were relevant to him. Hello, Dave. No, I haven't already done the main talk. I'm still doing the main talk. We've just been sorting out some IT issues. Right then. So, the interesting thing here, and
hello.
I can pop over the thing a bit. Is that you have also the information given to Blue versus the information given to Red on the previous page. But more interesting, you have the beginning of section 2, which is the cruiser problems. And the cruiser problems are kind of interesting. They go very much economic warfare and surface radar. In fact, basically this whole rulebook is about the Royal Navy putting together a set of parameters for their future operations, for what they're going to be doing and how they're going to be working. It works quite well. But this is where they start to think, okay, what are we going to do? What is going to be a warfighting scenario? And that's where we get to this one. And remember, I just introduced you to the phrase strategical. The difference in that is that the Royal Navy is basically strategical versus strategic is the Royal Navy's idea of grand strategy, what they're going to be doing. And you go through this and you have the context of a strategical exercise. Strategical exercises are massively massive. Basically,
hello.
Strategical exercises are about the Royal Navy developing something which is going to fight a global war and is going to engage in a massive battle. An absolutely colossal battle. And the kind of battle we're talking about... is something which... we're talking about, these are the exercises where the Royal Navy brings together the Atlantic and the Mediterranean fleet, where they bring everything together to fight a huge, huge battle. Now, Jeff Beeler has quite nicely linked me straight into my next point. Yeah, Jeff, interesting, the presence of a blue carrier indicates that they were thinking of the French, US, and Japan as adversaries. What tactics did the blue have to use? Everything. Okay? So, the red and the blue forces, their job was to go to war with each other. There was nothing off limits. Admirals would have personal wagers which went to huge, huge boxes of alcohol, and the raw ships as well, if they were considered to perform well in these things, could get awards and trophies, much like today. If they do well in exercises, they can get awards and trophies. The whole thing was massively competitive. And in one exercise prior to World War II, you have tribal class destroyers on both sides, and there is an absolute in one of the destroyer battles, because the two tribal flotillas are going knuckle to knuckle at each other, trying to take each other out. This is part of the Royal Navy's philosophy of how it's developing itself for war. They are never really thinking of Blue Fleet or Red Fleet as being them and the enemy. They're always treating Blue Fleet and Red Fleet as if they could be both the British, because whilst Red Fleet might be surface raiders and Blue Fleet might be defending against surface raiders, that could be what the British are doing in a war against Germany and Italy or anywhere in the rest of the world. But of course, remember, if we're talking about a war with Japan, the British were just as likely to be the surface raiders. So the British weren't thinking, okay, you have to be one enemy or another, you have to be another nation. They were thinking, you have to be as capable and as dangerous as you can be. So, this leads us to the actual exercises. Bayonet hammer. How expensive were these two exercises? They must have cost quite a bit. Yeah, they cost a lot. But actually, that was one part of the defense budget the government were never complained about spending money on. It's kind of interesting scenario. There you go. Well, that's weird. Stephen Cross, are you ever going to do a talk on presentation about one of the fathers of the Royal Navy, Admiral Fisher? Do you have any thoughts about him? I do have thoughts about him, and I will do a talk about him at some point, but I'm not exactly the most nicest on him. Jerishan, was there any submarine warfare in these? Yes, there was. Oh god, I've deleted that picture now to try and reduce the thing. But one of the first things they had was submarines who passed these exercises. There were submarines every single exercise. And if I pop up this one from one of the exercises now, there were submarines, aircraft, and destroyers involved, and both sides would have both. This is an actual exercise table. So these are the results of the draw for alternative operation and the instructions. These are what they're talking about. And it was these exercises which in many ways drove the realization of multi-role aircraft, but it was also limited space on carriers. So Jeff Beale is pointing out that the Swordfish was the first multi-role torpedo spotter reconnaissance aircraft. Actually, that forgets another role the Swordfish had, which was she was a torpedo spotter reconnaissance bomber aircraft and could theoretically do dive bombing. Although, I don't think anyone ever tried it operationally. They used whatever subs and whatever things they had available to make these exercises as massive as they could do. So, what role did any surviving K-class and River-class fleets on respecting these exercises? Exactly as that. They were fleet submarines. And they were still used as stuff. They were very useful for those exercises. And they had fun with them. So. Now, these exercises are about real fleet world operations. So, let's see. Can I get... No. Wrong one. Go away. There we go. So, this is exercise MZ. And I want you to all very carefully look at the coast. Look at the coast outline. Where does it look like to anyone? Yep, that's North Africa. They were actually down in the Mediterranean, and that's a normal thing for the Royal Navy. These exercises would take over the Mediterranean. And actually, I have another one in my sets here, which... as you can see, is just the south of Sicily. Both these exercises were conducted at night, And by 1929, night exercises were a common practice for the Royal Navy. And when I say night exercises, there was a figure earlier which was given during an exercise, courageous and launched and recovered 80 aircraft. There was 80 sorties. They were all conducted at night. And that was in 1929. The Royal Navy consistently were doing these exercises where they were working daylight, nighttime, everything, from about 1925 onwards. In fact, if it was not unusual to have exercises which could last for 5 or 6 days of non-stop fighting. So you'd have Red Fleet and Blue Fleet going at it over an area the size of half the Mediterranean for most of a week. And the French and Italian Navy were just told to keep out the way. And they did. As you can see, they were actually taking part in convoy protection operations off the coast of Sicily. They were doing an exercise in 1929 about how to defend a convoy off the coast of Sicily. Foreshadowing much? Stephen Cross, I assume the huge focus on night exercise is because of what happened in Jutland. It certainly starts out to an extent that way. Okay, the exercises start out as night exercises because, and this is always a problematic one, they start out as night exercises because the Royal Navy is very much thinking, we are going to have to fight this kind of war. We are going to have to be able to fight at night because the Germans got past us. But, and this is the thing, after that, as time goes on, night fighting becomes the Royal Navy's X factor, their ability to do operations when others couldn't. And their abilities, most importantly, to succeed when others couldn't. Basically, they were planning on night fighting as their way of managing to, they were planning on night fighting as their way of getting round numbers, as their way of actually compensating for the limitations they had. So if they were fighting outnumbered, they could fight at night. And it's because of exercises like this that I am in nicest way as hard as I am possibly on Somerville in 1942-43, because, as I said, when Operation C, he does the right decision, but it's not the RN right decision. And that's because if you consider these exercises, they have them going on and they have upsets. You have a scenario where the Blue Fleet carrier or the Red Fleet carrier manages to wipe out the other carriers at night. It's lucky sometimes, sometimes it's unlucky, but they manage to do it. And they manage to hit the battleships and slow the battleships. So the smaller fleet is then able to engage. And the Royal Navy keeps practicing that. You have to remember, these exercises were not 1929, we've had the exercises, we're done. These exercises I've got for 1929, 1934, 1935, 1936, 1938. And that's not all the exercises. That's just the ones which still have files in the National Archives. Phil Weir has managed to track down ones which are from elsewhere. So the amazing thing about these archives is that they are there and these exercises are happening. Okay, right then. Jeff Beeler, did having fewer squadrons lead to giving the squadron commanders more initiative to engage the enemy? Yes. But also, during these exercises, you often have a scenario where the umpires specifically kill off senior officers. They go, you're dead, you're dead. And they force people to take command. And one famous exercise in 1935, HMS Warspite ends up under the command of a lieutenant commander. because all the officers more senior to him had been killed in a hit on the bridge, because they'd all be on the bridge having a meeting, and it was simulated as there was an air attack, bomb hit the bridge, you're all gone, the most senior surviving officer is a lieutenant commander. I think it was a lieutenant commander gunnery. Frosty, fighting at night to make up for numbers. Is that not the same thing the Japanese were doing? The Japanese weren't really fighting at night. That's the thing. The Japanese and Americans are both very slow to get into the night fighting, especially the night flying part of things. And there are very good reasons why not to. You have to do a lot of emissions. You have to do a lot of things at night which give away your position to make night flying practical in this period. The Royal Navy decides that the benefits outweigh the costs, other navies don't, and it takes a while for them to get into it. Carl Gergen, beside Italian Japanese, who else the Iron was thinking she'd fight? The USN? Yep. The Iron's nightmare scenario involves the USN, the US suddenly deciding that they want to declare war on Britain. That they end up with some sort of, just as Germany had elected a extremist leader, America suddenly elects an extremist leader, and they end up fighting a war. The Royal Navy has to prepare for it, because they're the other navy which is just as big as them. You know, it's a nightmare scenario. In fact, the Royal Navy's massively, massively worst dream nightmare scenario is probably USA, Japan, Germany, Italy all ganging up on Britain. If the French are along as well, it doesn't really matter. They don't make any difference at that point. But they are working out these things and looking out for them because they have to. RF4. Does the RF's decision to own night, so to speak, influence other service branches like the RF? Interesting enough, you have these fights going on where the RAF Fighter Command, which has far stronger links and the single service fighters with the Fleet Air Arm, who are the other single engine plane users, are having a far greater obsession with night flying than the Bomber Command, because the RAF view is the bomb will always get through, especially from the Air Ministry. And it's only when they start to develop radar and start to think, oh, hang on, there are air defences that could work against bombers, they then use that pool, that chain of knowledge. In fact, some of the first instructors on night flying navigation are Royal Navy observers who've been doing this for years by this point, because observers in the Royal Navy were also the navigators of the aircraft, and they're the ones who go in to teach the first night pathfinder squadrons how to navigate at night. And it's this pool of knowledge which is then used by the RAF to turn their heavy bomber force into a night bomber force so quickly in the late 1930s. Yes, the USN did focus on long-range gunnery during the day, and that was their plan, was to try and bash the enemy at range during daylight hours. The Royal Navy's plan was to cripple them at night and then do what they liked to them in the daytime. This is, again, the thing. For the Royal Navy, they weren't worried whether they got a ship kill or a mission kill. If you manage to damage a aircraft carrier enough that it can't move quick enough to launch aircraft, it's as good as out of the fight. If you manage to take an aircraft carrier out, that's great. If you damage a battleship so it has to go slow, the enemy will slow down its entire fleet to look after that battleship, and while they're going slow, you can maneuver to wherever you like in relation to them. Force A1, Phil Weir, yes, there are, have a list of exercises by year in dependency of thesis, there are multiple exercises, there are a lot of exercises every year. There are major ones, at least twice a year, where you have the Atlantic and the Mediterranean fleet get together and basically go bash it out. But the other exercises will be going on as well. Um, Jeff Beeler, realistic, as Prince of Wales lost everyone but the CO versus the Bismarck. You know, the Royal Navy was not afraid to simulate battle damage. Regularly in exercises you'd find command of destroyers would drop down to a lieutenant because the bridge crew were wiped out or something like that. They were really keen on young officers being able to achieve command. And actually, there is a rumour which I've never been able to check that every single first officer on a tribal class destroyer by when World War II began had in an exercise ended up when they were a lieutenant in command of a destroyer. So there is that rumour. I'm not sure if it's true though. USN's proceedings had an essay last year on the need of declaring admirals and CEOs as casualties in naval war exercises. You do. You have to. This is fundamentally part of the structure of the Royal Navy exercises, but it's fundamentally part of their thinking process. Who takes command? Who's got to make decisions? Because you've still... The most scary thing and the bigger time you're most likely to lose people in a battle are when you stop making decisions. And exercises are the chance for you to really get that to work. For you to really manage to work out, okay, we can stop the. We can still survive. Because if you stop making decisions, if you stop having decisions going on, you are going to get into trouble. You're going to lose things. Iskandar. Aside from full-scale exercises, did they do much tabletop wargaming in the 1930s? I know it was used extensively during World War II. I suppose you can't do exercises in the middle of a shooting war. Actually, they did do exercises in the middle of a shooting war as well. The Royal Navy continued doing exercises throughout World War II as a way to warm up task groups. And sometimes these exercises were more theoretical exercises. And there'd be things like the carrier battle groups, the carrier's own aircraft would go off and then come in and attack this carrier battle group and these sort of things. They would do exercises. But yes, they were doing tabletop exercises as well. They were doing masses of them at Greenwich. Sheppy 42, I did hear while the Japanese were slow to go for night flying, they were training for torpedo strikes at night in particular. This is one of those interesting scenarios. The IJN do start to train some specific squadrons for night flying. But, due to the way the IJN's air wings are structured, and I will have to get into this in depth to explain it properly, they don't generate the same way that the British or American air wings do. They train up a whole air wing and then that goes out sort of thing. It's more, far more a group mentality. Whereas with British it would be sort of triple manning. There'd be replacements would come through and replacements come through. It wouldn't be a whole group. So you have a problem for the IJN in that as war goes on, they lose more and more of their experienced pilots and their level of training goes down because they aren't so good at passing on the experience. So, yes, they try to train them up, but they don't often have access to them, and they can never really mount the big night strikes. Which is why Pearl Harbor takes place in the daytime. Imagine Pearl Harbor, if the Japanese had really put the effort into night flying and night attacking, Pearl Harbor could have been far, far more dangerous if it had happened during the daytime and during night. Because if you consider the level of damage Swordfish managed to achieve at Taranto in night, imagine how the much more successful the dive bombers, Zeros and torpedo aircraft of the Japanese could have been if they'd been attacking the Americans tonight. If you'd been attacking the American fleet on a Friday night when everyone was out having drinks and having a nice time in the bars ashore, rather than a Sunday when they're all asleep. I don't know whether you've seen them or not, Douglas Clark, but there was a super chat. Was there? There was a super chat. Good Lord, thank you. I didn't know. Please post a discard invite code again. Yes, I will do. I will quite very happily do, Jack Ray. No, sorry, hadn't seen that. For some reason, it doesn't flash up on this screen. It flashes up on the other screen. I'm going to have to work that one out. Let's see. Let's see if I can solve that one quite quickly. To add in... a super chat function. So now I've got a super chat function down there. Let's hope it still works. Who knows? Right, so, thank you for that. Stephen Cross, questions about AA doctrine. That won't let me scroll this wide. That's annoying. Yeah, I'm just going to do that. And hope that allows me to scroll again. Right then. Strategic class, are they still doing so many large exercises in the RN? It's called the Thursday War. Every Thursday, every ship in the Royal Navy and every aircraft in the Royal Navy that can fly and is in the UK goes to war against itself. It's colossal. It's Armageddon. It's every Thursday. Thank you, Perry, for pointing out at Jack Gray's super chat. Thank you very much. I'm not sure why the super chat is being quite so... there. So hopefully it works. Not sure, it's being a bit weird. If I have super chat activated, it won't allow me to... It will allow me to do that. Okay. Dr. Scott, I meant to destroyers and night cruisers, Sheppy 42. I think you said something earlier. I did hear Japanese were slow to go for night flying, but they were trained for torpedo strikes. Yes, their destroyers were especially trained for night strikes, but their cruisers less so. 4-1, weren't the IGN air groups tied to individual carriers? Yes. What happened was they would train up an air group, and then it would go with the carrier and be mated to the carrier, and it was very much... bedded into that carrier. It wasn't so much as the squadron system, flight system, and the various trickle manning systems that the British and the American had. So you would have to generate an entire air group really to make it work properly again. There's a very, very good book on it which I've got, which explains it. Sitting around me somewhere. Where is my book on the Japanese? Oh, where is it? It's colossal, it's grey. It's got the rising sun on it, and I cannot see it for the life of me. I do have it. Ah, there you go. Right. To be honest, this is probably easier. This one. But as you can see, it's kind of buried at the moment. So, I will get to it at some point and I will show it off. I'll probably do another book review and Q&A session on Sunday, so I'll make sure to have it then. Stephen Cross, questions about AA doctrine. Did the RN keep its ships close together for mutual support like the USN did, or did they prefer dispersed formations relying on the rudder for AA added like the IJN did? They preferred dispersed. They preferred dispersed, but within ranges that they could provide mutually support. The RN very quickly... Well, as I explained with HMS Gurkha, she tried charging an air group. Air attack to drive them off to stop them attacking... to stop them attacking a convoy. You know, it's fun times. But... it's the Royal Navy prefers the looser group, and even towards the end of World War II, you've got Vian and the USN having regular arguments about how his carriers and his task force should be organised, and Vian going, I'm keeping them loose and it's fine. And the USN going, you need them tight, you need them tight, you need to mass the firepower. And him going, we are massing the firepower, but we're looser so we can manoeuvre more.
I don't want to sink my own destroyers.
I, 99 Andrew, I've just watched a Japanese player in the game of War in the Pacific lose two aircraft carriers to three old Royal Navy light cruisers aloft.
The town class were very good in exercises at hunting light aircraft carriers. It's thanks to the town class that basically the tribals and the didos, well, not just the town class, the county class as well, that the tribals and the didos are built as pretty much carrier bodyguards. That is part of their definite production.
Deesnitz, would it be perhaps be accurate to describe most of the Navy's attitude and night actions as mostly pre-battle skirmishing, opposed to British aiming to carry out a complete battle in darkness? I haven't ever thought about it like that, but you could certainly make the case quite strongly. Would Taranto have gone badly if it happened in daytime?
Do you want to take a swordfish into a position where it's got surrounded by machine guns and you're still feel...
As I explained when I was discussing Taranto last time and talking about Royal Navy Aviation, for a swordfish to have really long range and carry a torpedo, what happened was the observer moved into the gunner's seat, the telegraphist air gunner's seat, the tag seat, that to man the gun as well as lunar reconnaissance, and there's a huge fuel tank put in the observer seat in the center. Now, the cockpit is divided in two. There's sort of two tubs. There's the tub which the observer and the gunner sit in, and there's the tub the pilot sits in. This fuel tank would leak. So all the pilots, and it would find a level, all the observers actually, who went into Taranto, who had this gun and this tank fitted, and all the aircraft Swordfish did, were waist deep in aviation fuel. Now, it is brave going into a firefight at night waist deep in aviation fuel. In daytime, that's just beyond the pale, beyond the call of duty. Jeff Beeler, did they ever do any planning to land two or more complete infantry battalions, infantry divisions, over open beaches? That was pretty much what the Royal the amphibious warfare doctrine was leading towards, landing craft. It was probably going to be open beaches, but it's, you know, it's okay. This was Reading and Perry Roden. This was showing a stream for a few seconds and was transitioning between off and online status. I have no idea why. It wasn't telling me anything. Ooh. We'll see. Typical Thursday war these days is 2 to 3 RN units and 1 to 2 international units, sometimes fewer. Big Eric's those twice annual joint warriors in NATO. Yes, they are. But let's be honest, every week you've got the equivalent of a third of the Royal Navy's escort force going to war. That's quite a big battle. That's quite big, fighting. And he's found a big... I'm Sheppy 42. I'm not quite sure where the big red meatballs come from. Their carrier groups were integral parts of the ships and modular. Jeff Beeler, the Shattered Sword talks about the Japanese carrier doctrine, especially at Midway. Their carrier groups were integrated parts of the ships, not modular like the USN and Iron. Yeah, it's a different system. It fits with the Japanese approach.
And you have to remember the Japanese have far more likely to have NCO and pilots than the other two navies. Although I think both the USN and the Royal Navy, well, the Royal Navy definitely does, but the USN I think does as well, due to wartime. Let's see what questions are coming up. Oh good, it's going past. I'm having to watch the questions quite quickly. Waist deep in aviation fuel beats being sprayed with castor oil and the resultant effects. Ian Greenley, I'm not sure. Being waist deep in aviation fuel and going into tracer fire is not fun. Ah, big rent Chevy 42, that does make sense. Yes, it is a rising sun kind of. Jeff Beeler, Lexington's Air Group was an ACA and NCO pilot based. I thought they did, but I don't like to, when I'm not sure, I always mention I'm not sure. That's my promise to you. If ever I'm not 100% sure on something, I always say when I'm 100% sure. I always hate it when I see historians on television talking stuff and I'm sitting there going, we only know of one document saying that. We don't know the reality. No one who was alive at that time is still alive, so we can't check. So you're saying everything based off one document. That's a strong possibility at best. We'll see. 99. Royal Navy 1932 at time of Falklands had around 70 frigates and destroyers. Today a nominal 19. Many ships paid off. We won't get into that one. I can spend a long time talking about them. So, the rebuild of Japanese got a lot of use of long Congos more than some of their cruisers. Wow, the questions are coming in quick. This is good. Enjoying this. Right then. Was the Bicheron, was the RNS focused on night fighting in the war because of the night action drill? It was in part. As I said, that started off, but afterwards it got more and more. It became more and more because they started. Once you start doing it and you notice other people aren't doing it, you sort of go, hang on, we can do this. Okay. Victory will be ours. It won't matter how outnumbered we are. We'll fight them at night, when they're all still asleep in their beds. We'll take them out, down into the briny deep. Sorry, my Halloween costume's coming through.
The first team... Yeah. What's fun is when I see the books being recommended here and they're literally on my shelves around me.
RAF air crew included more NCOs as the war went on by necessity. What about the FAA? They did as well, Greg Sadowski. They did as well. As time went on, the FAAs included more. But to be honest, one of the interesting things is the Fleet Air Arm and the Army were always far more reluctant about the idea of being all officer-based than the Air Force. The Air Force were always the ones keen on that idea. Baynard Hammer, what kind of surprises were built into war games by the planners, referees, e.g.? Intervention by a third-party country? Usually they didn't need to put it, they did sometimes put in those surprises. They did certainly did put in extra countries coming in and a squadron suddenly appearing out of nowhere and you randomly assigning to whichever group. But as a rule, having the Mediterranean Commander-in-Chief versus the Atlantic Fleet Commander-in-Chief and telling them that whoever won would have more of a chance of becoming First Sea Lord was motivation enough for Armageddon to break out. I don't think it is possible for me to put a Discord invite on there, but I will see if I can post one straight into the comments underneath this. Let's see if I can do it. So, you're going to be live watching me deal with computing. So if it goes wrong and I actually do start swearing online, it's your fault. Nah. I love you all. Right then, let's see if I can make this work. And there you go. There should be, live, a link. Yay, it worked. Night navigation and distances always explains, Jeff Beeler, the need for the second of the observer. In nicest way, if you're going to be navigating long range at night, you need someone to be a navigator, especially pre-GPS. This is one of the reasons why the Royal Navy is going for a second person. This is one of the reasons why they are prepared to accept what they are in aircraft performance for the aircraft they want. Brock Plane, did the ships fire at each other in the exercises and use some sort of offsets for our aiming? Right. So, yes, theoretically they were supposed to fire. They often tried to fire blanks. They also fired paint shells one year. They tried out from memory, which got red splotches everywhere because Warspite went nutty with them. And they used offset as well, and they did predicted firing, so they basically would take a likelihood for the chance of it, and they would go, yep, okay, we'll use that as the chance. Turning 343, you have no idea how scary that laugh is with the latency issues.
Yeah.
Well, it could be useful. Okay. I know your love for the renown, but if the twins had turned on her during the engagement off Norway, how do you think it could have gone, Stephen Cross? Theoretically, they should have won. Theoretically. But the fact is, she gets some lucky hits in early, and she is driving them hard. So, you know, she's got the bigger, more powerful guns, and she is a well-worked-up, well-practiced ship. She's driving them hard. So I'd actually put my money on Renown for that one. I think it could have been a very interesting battle. No, actually, Jeff Beeler, Renown didn't have any destroyers. She left all her destroyers behind her to go as fast as she could to try and reach Glowworm. Basically, Glowworm had been part of Renown's group, and when Glowworm signaled that she was under attack by Hipper, Renown went full mother hen to try and get to her destroyer, which was being beaten up by a cruiser. She didn't find Hipper, she found Scharnhorst and Neisenau. And that was good night Vienna. Watching the streams of videos on RM made me want to play RM Cruise and Destroyers in World of Warships. Okay. Stephen White, USN Fleet Pacific really was San Diego based. In Hawaii, it trains all week and rest of the sun, hence the fleet is sunny. Yeah, the Hawaii system was not really good for them. If French patrimoine was null after the French armistice and the merchants had joined the UNFN, how much more would that have even assisted in giving in the operation of it? It would have been difficult. But one of the big problems with the French ships when they came over was finding them shells, because all their guns were different. It's really annoying. They hadn't standardized as much as the Americans and the Brits had. 99 Duke. At Dr. Alex Clark, would you say the RN 1930s in World War II got back to their 18th, early 19th century roots of aggression and initiative for relatively junior officers after World War I? Yes. Basically, they found that prior World War I, they'd been going down a doctrine which was increasing centralization, and it hadn't worked. Sing Cross, it was in a storm condition. The DDs fell back because the sea state was terrible. Yes, they did fall back because the sea state was terrible, but they were trying to keep up, and honestly, technically, Renown should have stayed with her destroyers. But she didn't. She went on to try and avenge her poor, beloved destroyer, which had been sunk. Steffi 42, Dr. Clark, with your focus on destroyers, have you any thoughts on other nation destroyers like the Fubukus, the Fletchers, the German overweight position? Basically, the different destroyers. The different destroyers are. You have the Fletchers, which are underarmed in some respects but overarmed in others. You have the Japanese, who are very focused on their torpedoes, as much as the British are, in fact even more so. And you have each navy is really building their destroyers to fight the battle as they see fit. It's what kind of battle do they want to fight. It's what do they want to do. I'm hoping the Discord link is working, by the way. So the more you can, the more they can build a ship to fit their needs, to fit their style, the better. And they will do. This means that I am very reluctant in engaging in top trumps, because here's the thing. On the top trump record, when you're looking at it, the Grass Bay should have been able to beat every single one of the cruisers that the Royal Navy put against it at the Battle of River Plate. I know there has been a paper produced by someone looking at various statistics which he says, no, they should have sunk the Grass Bay. It's lovely on a computer scenario to be able to say they should have sunk it because of this. If you've done this tactics and this tactics, then knowing what I do in hindsight, I can say all this. Lovely. But the reality is, in the scenarios it was at the time, if she caught Exeter solo, if she caught the two light cruisers, Ajax and Achilles solo, they'd have probably divided and tried to attack again, much as Exeter did and they did, to try and divide and cover. The only ship in the South Atlantic Division which could really go toe-to-toe with the Grass Bay was her fellow heavy cruiser HMS Cumberland, which kept missing her and was furious because of that. In fact, here's the interesting thing about that one. Grass Bay almost ran into HMS Cumberland right at the beginning of the war, weeks before everything else. She only missed her by the skin of her teeth. And if she'd been caught, by gum, there would have been a battle royale, because Cumberland was one of the most well-worked-up county-class, modernised counties that the Royal Navy had available, and that would have been an interesting what-if history. Okay. Jeff Beeler, how far back were they? One account I read said they were there. I'm not sure what that's about. There's a nice conversation going on. See what? There is a famous incident of nighttime Japanese pilots trying to land on US carrier. Oops. Yes. Well, these things happen. Life happens. Sheffy 42. Yeah, top trumps while fun every now and again is kind of pointless, but comparisons of strengths and weaknesses is cool. Broadly speaking, if you want a long-range, highly maneuverable, heavy torpedo destroyer, you want to go for the Japanese. If you want to go for a medium-range, heavy torpedo, slightly more armored destroyer, you go for American. If you want to go for quite strong torpedoes, medium range, fairly heavy gunned, you go tribal class, British. If you want to go lightly gunned, but all the rest, you go for the rest of the Royal Navy destroyers. And it's basically, it depends on what they're looking at, because the Royal Navy goes, well, we could build a destroyer to operate in the Pacific, but then it'd be useless in the Atlantic. Because the Royal Navy destroyers all have these huge freeboards. And one of the interesting things is the Americans noticed quite early on with the British destroyers,
is they ride very well in deep in choppy waters compared to their destroyers. And the Americans start looking at the British hulls very carefully because they're going, theoretically we've got the same stats here, how's your hull doing this? And it's because of the way the British have been doing a lot of testing in wave tanks and have been developing the hulls properly. And these have come from the exercises. Actually, the big exercises, especially the ones which are big exercises that take place in the Atlantic. Okay, so the Royal Navy prefers to do the massive exercises in the Mediterranean. It's calmer, you can just go and fight it out, and you're not going to have to be fighting the waves so much. But they still, every few years, do some in the Atlantic. And that's when they have real, real fun. Because if you can imagine a North Atlantic, and sometimes these take place in September, October, sometimes they're in the spring, lovely, February, March, huge waves going up and down like that, and you're bobbing around trying to kill each other. It trains the Royal Navy in what they need to do. And that affects how the Royal Navy designs things. It also affects how the other navies design things. It's what they've got to do.
Bishan, I'd like to see you in a debate with Dr. Alan Zim of the SNI over Commodore Harwood. You probably wouldn't. there is a reason why the Lawton Department, as much as I enjoy working with them and as proud I am of Kings, keep me as far away from wargaming as they can. I am the one who walks in and asks the awkward questions like, oh, you've got a nice set of dice there, and it has 18 opportunities. In what case in real world is there only 18 possible outcomes? I love them, and I think wargaming has its place. I am very, very supportive of wargaming, and what it did to help Max Horton and others in World War II with the convoy battles is frankly amazing, especially the whole discovery of working out where the submarines were attacking convoys from. They thought they all were outside the convoys, they found they were actually inside the convoys, was thanks to wargaming. But I do find it slightly annoying when we look back and we put a program hindsight into a modern computer system and we go, this is what would happen. And you go, well, yeah, everything's happening perfectly. Everything's working perfectly. Have you checked every maintenance report on those ships? Do you know everything that's working on? Because a ship which has been at service for 10 years is going to behave differently than it was when it was built. You know, there's all sorts of issues get involved. It's just... It's a lovely thing. It's a lovely thought process. It's a lovely thought game. But I'm not sure of it as a real-world teaching system to go and back and do it and swear by it, as Zim seems to. Oh, Shepherd 42. Fubukis could be considered one of the most influential destroyer types. What you always have to remember is that the Royal Navy is a bit of an outlier in many, many things. So, you see competition going on between the Americans and the Japanese. And you see the French and the Italians doing the competition. And you see lots of the Royal Navy and people write books. So, the Royal Navy built this as a response to them. And then you go look at the designs. Well, the designs were coming through long before those ships entered service or even were known about. And you start to realise that the Royal Navy often uses the excuse of other nations' productivity to build its ships, often saying, this is why we're building this ship. But the reality is something far more complicated, because the Royal Navy, no matter how much it might like to respond to something, always has to think about the whole global war scenario. It always has to think, hang on, we have to fight across the whole world. Okay. Right. We have to be able to fight in all these places. Do you think if they'd been able to keep it, a somewhat modernized Tiger would have been useful or any use or reliability? Probably in the Falklands War, I think, Stephen Cross, you're talking about. And honestly, I would prefer to have had a modernized Daring 49 than a Tiger. It would have been the same shell type that everyone else was using. Ian Carr, how effective were Japanese ASW? Interesting enough, post-World War I, when they'd be training up the Royal Navy in the Mediterranean, very, very good. But it doesn't seem to stay at the same level. it seems to go down. So actually, I would have said, if we were talking about the navies in the world in 1918, the Japanese Navy is one of the best in the world at anti-submarine warfare. The trouble is, they don't seem to improve as much in the interwar period as other navies do, and I'm never quite sure why. I haven't really done enough reading to really look into it. Jeff Beale, looks like the renowned DDs were part of the engagement at the start and the Lutrans mistook the... I don't think they were there. I think, in the nicest way, they'd been left behind quite a long time. They were possibly still somewhere in a distance. There was smoke, but I don't think they were actually in any range visible for them. Knight and Iron Duke, could HMS Tiger have defeated the Argentinian, defeated Belgrano? I honestly don't think they'd have got within gun range. I have a feeling missiles would have been flying first, but if they had got within gun range, it would have been interesting. Tiger's guns were theoretically quicker firing and had more penetration because they were newer design, but she had less of them. These are all the interesting things which we could go into. Ian Greenlee, ARN loves to recycle ship names, but what is your favourite unique RN ship name? The ship I think most likely should come back at some point is HMS Nubian, because she's only literally one battle on a shy of Warspite. But we're always talking about Warspite. There's a few names I quite like. I would like another HMS Victory. I honestly think that we should just have the one which is Victory 1805 sitting in the harbour as the fleet flagship and have another Victory. But you know, HMS Ark Royal is definitely one I want to see again. HMS Royal Sovereign, definitely always a cool name to have. HFB, like, I saw one account that had HMS Tiger rearmed with 14-inch, like those. No. That's just not going to work. She couldn't take a 14-inch. It would have wrecked her hull. Good lord, the questions are coming through. Right then. What do you think of Marine National super destroyers like the Fantastique, Steam Cross? They were an interesting design. They were a good design to destroyer, but they were built more to counter the Italians than the idea of a Mediterranean war than a global war. Hey, thank you, Perrin, and thank you. Let me go check for the super chats. It's not showing me the super chats for some reason. That's fun times. Oh, thank you, Jim. Chris Holm. And thank you, everyone. Very kind of you. Zubian. Oh. Ian Carr. What names or warships are most... Can we please have a new HMS Temeraire capable of going to sea? Now that would be nice. HMS Temeraire. I actually always thought that one of the T-class boats should have been named a Temeraire, but no, they didn't. Jeff Eeler, why did the RN not use the 4.5-inch mounts on Ark Royal on its destroyers until the battle class? Honestly, because even the ones used in the battle class were deck-penetrating systems. So, you have to understand, usually destroyers have non-deck-penetrating weapons. They are all lighter, and they're supposed to be mounted up so that all the gubbins are pretty much up in the turret. But for the Baba class, they had to basically redesign the inside of a destroyer's hull, which is why they're the size they are, because some of the workings are down deep inside inside the ship. It's a deck penetrating system, and they do that just to quickly get these guns in service, but they are using the ones which are designed for capital ships. So that's another reason that holds up the battle class, actually, is because they're using guns which capital ships could be using. Mm-hmm. yes, Jeff Beeler, Zubian, Greg Sadsky, H-Man Zulu plus Newman stuck together is H-Man Zubian. Yeah, that is a good one. Bitteran, would Tiger be better with unified armament of 3-4 twin 4.5 inch guns instead of 6 and 3 inch guns? I would have certainly thought she'd have been better. Certainly would have been easier to maintain. But no, they went with the 6 inch and the 3 inch guns because that was what they were going with at the time. Carl Gangan, but Victory is still in commission. That's why you changed her name to Victory 1805. You don't need to decommission her, you just call her Victory 1805. Kate Jameson is obviously not watching this, otherwise I would be getting absolute hate mail coming through on WhatsApp now for daring to suggest this. So please, no one tell her I just did. I don't want to be killed. Jerison, she couldn't take 14 inch, it would have wrecked her hull. That's what she said, yeah. I'm not getting into that, Mr. Richardson, but very good. Ingrid, Tillman's HMS incomparable. Just how big a BB would have got if there had been no 1922 treaty and you had docks of infinite size?
It depends if you still want to be able to make it through the Suez. Probably about 45 to 48,000 tons. But I'm not sure if it gets much bigger than that. I think in nicest way, the Royal Navy are quite happy with about 40,000 tons for theirs. There is a certain point at which, when you're doing the Congress, etc., you're making them so expensive and so massive, you're sinking a lot into one basket. And the Royal Navy's never keen on that. At 99 Andrew, at Dr. Eric Clark, what does the RN fleet look like in 1943 if there is no war until then? Well, you've got the Tigers, the proper battleships. You've got 15-inch guns wandering around of those. You've got probably 6 or 7 modern carriers in service, fleet carriers. 3 or so light carriers, including Unicorn, probably at this point, because the treaties have run out and aren't being renewed, and everyone's probably doing escalator clauses. You have probably got the battle class in service, because the Royal Navy were looking at larger destroyers anyway, and they were heading that way. You are probably talking there has been a crash sloop building program. They were already talking about that, and honestly they were looking at the trawlers and the corvettes, so wouldn't be surprised if by 1943 there was a huge RN reserve with escorts armed up, and pretty much a lot of force. Crown colonies would have been still being built. You might have seen another one of the large towns come into service or similar to act as a cruiser flagship, and you would probably be definitely having more ships positioned around the world. I think the Royal Navy would probably have been would have probably been increasing the size of the Indian Ocean fleet. Now, this is where I get into debate with people, because they go, oh, they'd have deployed it to the Far East, That would have been a direct threat to Japan. Far easier to reinforce the Indian Ocean fleet so you can rapidly send the force into the Far East. But also, then you've got this force which can reinforce the Mediterranean if you need to move the Mediterranean fleet to support the Atlantic. Or the Atlantic can support the Mediterranean if the Mediterranean has to go to the Indian Ocean to support the Indian Ocean fleet can go into the Far East. Basically, if you do it that way around, it starts to work as a mutually supporting force.
Stephen 42, Dr. Clark, what would you say is the strangest but still useful ship? A monitor. Seriously, they are seriously freaky. But they're still very, very useful for operations, especially when you're supporting land operations. The Roberts class were critical. Frosty, promoting officers by seniority rather than performance seems to hurt innovation as per the Japanese. Yes. The Royal Navy has some issues with this occasionally, and so does the US Air Navy, but as a rule they both find ways of promoting good officers young quite quickly. Stephen White, that's an interesting thing. 2 gun crews of a USS Constitution were from HMS Victory. That's interesting. 471, didn't the Mark 8 guns of Bristol onwards fire modern base bleed ammunition? Would the earlier Mark 6 guns of the Darings have had ammunition commonality? Yes, they did actually. They the bleed out ammunition had actually been developed on the Mark 6 guns, which was still in use on the county class at this time. So the county still pretty much had the Mark 6 guns, and the Mark 6 guns were pretty much in use constantly. I don't think, as long as we had double mounts on ships, they were the Mark 6 guns. So until it gets to the single guns, but the counties were still around, there is still the ammunition there, and it's still working. Wouldn't she actually be HMS Victory 1765? You'd think, but we'd probably go for 1805. It sounds cooler. Night Heron Production. Hello, Night Heron Production. Haven't seen you so far today. Sorry if I missed you. Iron plans for war in the East, as you've outlined, was to utilize town and counties as commerce raiders, but would they, by 1942, be viable in that role, given Japan's proficient air power in the Pacific at that time? Yes, because no matter how much air power you have, you're still searching a lot of sea. And they would just be operating further out. In a nice way, what happens to Cornwall and Dorsetshire is not nice. But it happens because they're in a position where they shouldn't, where they get caught by a preponderance of air power. They get caught by it. And actually, if they carried on going south-west rather than south, so if Somerville hadn't sent a signal going, actually join up with me and force A as fast as you can, so they went straight south, so they were still in range of the carriers. If they'd gone southwest and then loop round, they'd have taken longer to reach Somerville, but they would have reached them.
Probably. Depends on carrier movements and those things, but that's the odds.
Mitchell, Tiger 6-inch guns better than Zumwalt's guns. At least Tiger had ammo. Yeah. Grace Hudson, re-unique ship names. I'll deny this. During the American War of Independence, the British captured the USS Independence and renamed that as HMS Dependence.
Yeah, I think there was a D-class cruiser as well, that name. I'm not sure, though. I'm still doing the research for that next. That one's the next week's one.
Do you think the RN should have built a new heavy counter cruiser using three triple 8-inch mounts on a Belfast hull?
No.
I think for the RN, the 6-inch was far better gun to go with at the time. The 8-inch, the interesting thing would be if you developed radar-directed firing after in 1939, 1940, if it comes into service, then you might start going for the 8-inch again, because you suddenly have the systems to make use of the 8-inch's range to actually use it at the maximum range. Whereas at the visual ranges, the 6-inch is getting more explosive to the enemy in the same time as the 8-inch. The RN does have a very long history of trolling things. Iskandar, USS President was called HMS President after capture, though. Yes. Technically for the President of the Board of Trade, which was the only President the Royal Navy the British had at the time. But it was very nice, and the President of Board of Trade was very happy, and that's why President was always so linked with London and the livery companies of London. So that's where she get. That's why HMS President is still the R&R unit in London today. She's that stone frigate. Pat W. No, the RN didn't have plans for supercruisers like the Alaska. That really wasn't ever in the RN's plans. They look at them, they do design studies, but it's mainly to go, this is an option. We can do this, we can build HMS Vanguard, or we can build an aircraft carrier. Frosty, in reference to the fleet question in 1943 before the war started, how constrained was RN shipbuilding due to the economic conditions in the world at the time? Okay, by about 1939, the gloves were pretty off, and the Royal Navy was getting pretty much what it wanted. The government had been slow to build up, but they were still, the RN was getting increased funding pretty much year on year. And this is another advantage Henderson has, because he has more money coming in anyway. So he's managed to navigate, and they've got a lot of things. So basically, construction goes like that. And so 1940 would have been this point, and then it would have started going up quite dramatically. Uh, Jeff Beeler, post a link to your book on the publisher's page so we can go for order through our favourite local bookstore. Travel Fun Zero suggestions from Modern Destroyer. I will do. When it comes out. When it comes out, I will post that. I will first have to look up to see if they have a link on their page. But I will post it out. At the moment, all I have is the Amazon link. mainly because the US and I are very keen on it. It was originally just going to be Pen and Sword. But it's been taken up by other people. And the more people who take it up, the better. Because then it definitely survives. Because currently, we're all worried because of all... author writers are currently worried that publishers are going to start dropping books because of the world economic moment. So the more pre-orders, the better, because it saves books. Start crowd. There's already a development contract out for the T-45 displacement. Yeah, there is. The Royal Navy automatically, as soon as the class enters service, they start working on two projects. One, its midlife upgrade, and two, its replacement. You do not, you cannot afford not to. It takes so long to get everything right because you're talking thousands upon thousands of systems. Stephen White, only Japanese captured critical point Singapore. Losses like that affect the war. Yeah, actually, here's the thing. I am going to be talking about counterfactual history. I have a What If History coming out in June. And you're going to like that because that is looking at the war in Southeast Asia and whether or not the Royal Navy, anything could have been done differently if the British could have won there and stopped the Japanese taking. Basically, everything hinges on Singapore. And I won't be giving away too much if I say that I have a very interesting book here, which is another one I recommend. If you haven't ever read it, I do apologise about some of the things in it. Not really. But Sir William Slim. And there was an option of he could have been sent to command the defences at Singapore versus the guy who was sent. The guy who was sent was nice but senior, so they sent him. I think they should have sent the bastard, but we'll leave that to one side, excuse the French there. Night Heron production. French submarine Surcouf, the one with 8-inch guns, are finished on a fate, and how was she intended to be used? Thought some on that, and how would you use her? Pierce, feels nice to have your presence or lack of noted. Well, that's nice, yes. Well, I do try and notice all of you because you're all very nice and you come here and you chat away with me and you give me something to do 2 days a week, which is far more interesting than sitting and just staring at the screen. It gives me a bit harder of a legitimate procrastination on writing. It gives me a legitimate reason to take some time off writing. As for the Surcouf, I'd rather not use her. But she was stacked with everything. She has boats, she has all sorts of things in her. She's a cruiser submarine. Her whole idea is that she's a surface raider, which actually has a chance of getting home because she can go underwater and get away. But she's supposed to use that 8-inch gun to take out merchant ships. I'd use her as that. I'd use her as a surface raider. I'd use her as a raider. But I'm not really sure how good she'd be for it. But honestly, I prefer a regular submarine. The amount of resources Surcouf takes to build and maintain versus regular submarines, I prefer the regular submarines. Force A1, do you think the larger preliminary designs, L-17, L-90, would be more or less useful than L-M classes if a destroyer is built? I will go with Henderson on this. He wanted the L-90s. I think the ones that are built were pretty good, but Henderson was arguing for the larger destroyers for a reason. They were useful. And he won the argument because they built the battle class. he died, he was dead, but I'm fairly sure from his grave he was going, I won. 1999 Duke, at Dr. Edward Clark, the Royal Navy just needs to find a way to stop the government cutting each succeeding glass to half the size of the one in process. If we can find a way to do that, we will be the magic navy of the Western world. Night Heron production, Nick Waters. I agree it was a bad idea, but then again, putting an R-class within a few miles of the French coast, utilising the confusion of a bombing raid, would seem some foolhardy, but it worked. So many things worked that it's quite disturbing. 742. So for this counterfactual, do Prince of Wales and Repulse have to last a little bit longer? Actually, it's going to sound strange, but I actually don't deploy them. I would have deployed them to the Indian Ocean, so they were there as a backing force to be called upon, but I would have used them to free up cruisers from the Indian Ocean to go to the Pacific, so they could go economic warfare on the Japanese. But, you know, this is getting jumping ahead of it, and this one's going to be coming up. Jeff Beale, the British built the submarine X1 with 2x5.25 inch. Yeah, the M1, M2, all sorts of things. Oh god. It's an idea, and you have to test out an idea. But it's kind of like when people say aircraft carrier submarines are a good idea these days. They look at them and go, really? Maybe an aircraft carrier, an SSGN style submarine, where some of the missiles are actually persistent UAVs or persistent air munitions. That could be something quite interesting, and that's a potential thing to go on, but that's something more for bilge pumps than it is for this. Steamcross, do you think that if they could have had the RN, would have recycled more gun turrets in the Vanguard? if they could have got them to work, they might have done, but I doubt it. Jeff Beeler, why did the RN not use the 4.5 inch mounts on the Ark Royal on its destroyers until the battle class? I think I covered that, didn't I? I think I said it's because it's the deck penetrating system. The Royal Navy prefers to use non-deck penetrating systems on its destroyers because they're lighter and they're more self-contained and they're easier to fit in with a destroyer design. When you're putting in a deck penetrating turret system like the 4.5s used on the battle class, you have to change all sorts of things down inside the hull. Howard King, what was the IGN war plan versus the Royal Navy? Ambush them in the Singapore Straits. Literally, that was the IGN war plan. It's a good one. Basically, it's what the Royal Navy was doing. So the Royal Navy and IGN were both planning for the same war fighting scenario, ambushing, fighting each other in the Singapore Straits. And this is the thing, Singapore then becomes crucial, because if you control Singapore, you can have land-based air support, if you've managed to get aircraft to it. That being the big if. 99 Duke, you would think that every, even very stupid and dishonest political types could see that a... Yeah, you'd always hope so. Second, at the first clock, are there any books you'd recommend when trying to create a more or less fictional navy beginning in 1927? Jane's Books on Ship Design of the Period Act. Avoid Jane's like the plague. You've all seen, basically. Hello. You've all seen me use this one. Select the Papers on British Warship Design. I've got the full big blue ones over there as well, but any of the John Roberts books are good. This one is a particular favourite of mine. Friedman's are good if you don't mind the fact that they have some interesting points in them. There is a more free debate about that subject on Twitter than there would be on YouTube. In Greenland, why does Brexit require a larger navy? France isn't going to become a threat, so what do we need more? In Greenland, the argument goes for a larger navy, and I do sort of agree with this, is that if we are going to reforge relationships, instead of relying on the EU as our relationship formation, but be going more of an independent approach around the world, then whereas the EU, you could maintain it, we're using EU presence, so as long as there was a French, a German or a British ship there, it didn't matter whose it was still the EU presence. Now the British are going to say, if they want to have a presence, and remember, if you want to have a say in anything that happens, you have to be there. Decisions are made by those who show up, not by those who show up from the back. So therefore the idea is you need more, a slightly larger Royal Navy to be in more presence. Basically, we're going to need to build more Type 31s and more river classes. Another Type 26 would be quite useful as well. Basically, the Type 26 and Type 45s, the carriers, the amphibious ships, there are the core deployable battle force. They're probably say the same number and they'll be used for warfighting. The present ships will be the Type 31s and river class, so expect to see them in the Gulf, forward deployed to Gibraltar maybe, forward deployed to Singapore, these sort of places to be more presence. So that's what we're talking about when we talk about expanding Navy. Not a huge, massive jump, but a few more ships probably are necessary. Okay. Jim Christian, Bilge Pump is the new podcast series which me, Drac, and armoured carriers are recording. Currently the first one is with SimSec waiting for them to publish it. Should be going up at some point this week. Possibly even tomorrow. We need to sort out music though, I think, for it. Nighthound Production, I've heard Jack suggest and I agree that tracer rounds for 4C might have worked that much better for repelling the aircraft assault due to psychological results upon the pilots. Your thoughts? Agreed. Actually, me and Jack, I think, have already talked about that one, and not only would I have liked tracer rounds, I would have definitely made sure that they had more 40mm on them if I could have. They needed the high impact guns. They didn't. They were very likely that armed for AA. Chevy 42. Also, if we're talking about dark submarine designs, why no love for the I-400, the aircraft carrier submarine? The I-400s of the Japanese Navy are—they're beautiful. They end up spending most of their war doing supply runs, which they are absolutely excellent at. They're supplying most of the forward independent island garrisons. At one point, I think post-war, the U.S. Navy actually managed to find an officer who'd served on one and asked him where the island garrisons were, because the Japanese had even forgotten where they were. Frosty, once the Japanese gained more land base in 1942, were not the RN commerce raiding cruisers had a difficult time against patrol planes and a ship land base?
Not really. Reason is, you are talking about most of those land bases, especially the ones in Asia, are also dealing with supporting the army. And you always have to remember there's a lot of problems in Japan before their army air force versus their navy air force and when they work together. So actually the Royal Navy could have exploited that. The Royal Navy might have been worried about it, but they'd probably done a few tests first, and if they found they could get away with it, they'd have gone away with it, because it would take a lot to get the Imperial Japanese Army and Navies to work together.
More than they actually did. Pat W, what books would you recommend on the life of a crew aboard a ship in peace and war?
Ooh. I've already done one about this, sort of, but this one's pretty good. Lower Deck by Lieutenant John Davies. And Sub-Lieutenant by Ludovic Kennedy. They're pretty good good books. I've got some more as well. Can't find a moment.
Trouble is with having a bookshelf, which is literally the books are packed in some cases two and three rows deep. You can't always find all your books. A slaughter cult one. If it is military, UK is still NATO. UK is still in NATO. When we're talking about presence, especially Navy around the world, you're not just talking about the sort of military thing. You're talking about the connections you build with diplomacy, hosting dinners and all these things. It's naval diplomacy and its presence and its... I did a whole load of papers on this a few years ago on the SimSec website and some more on my own blog. And basically presence is what we're talking about. It's the presence mission. It's the diplomat. It's the soft power side of naval forces. Frosty, how did the Tribals carry and load extra torpedoes? They were stored in special magazines, and loading is basically manpower. Pick up and lift as a crew. It's not good. It's fun, but it works. And you must remember, wasn't that long ago, you're talking about Sea Cat and Sea Slug missiles were pretty much manually loaded as well. Didn't the Royal Navy enter the Second World War with heavy anti-aircraft batteries to anyone else? Yes, they did, and they still weren't enough. Nick Waters, unless I know some of them, Drax seems very keen on preserving old Navy photos in public domain. Are there particular history museum causes you feel strongly on?
Yes. Lots of them. I actually was turned down recently. I put in because the Royal Navy Museums were advertising for new trustees. And I was turned down to be a trustee of the Navy Museums. I don't know why, but I just didn't make it through selection. But I am very, very passionate about getting Navy history out there and getting it done properly and effectively so that people of all ages can get involved in it. I am very, very keen to dispel a myth, which is that naval history and study of naval warfare is an elitist experience. Yes, my dad was a naval architect. Yes, my mum did also work at Lloyd's but for a bit. And yes, I suppose I come from quite a middle class in a way background, but I also come from a sort of poor background. I was a scholarship boy. I know I have the posh British accent, but this is because I was a scholarship boy. I was taken into a school based on my ability to do academic work and to make sure their grades looked good so they could charge other people a lot of fees. And I did my job well. My grades, even despite my dyslexia, were very high, and that made them very happy. But I do sometimes get pointed out by people, oh, no, we don't study history because it's what rich people study. It isn't. History is something which opens avenues and opens doors for people, and I want to get more people into it. It's why I do Twitter. It's why I do all the stuff with Global Maritime History I do. It's why I do pretty much everything I do, is to get more people actually interested in history. Not everyone has to go do a degree or a master's or a PhD or anything like that, and they don't have to do that. But I want people to actually enjoy and engage with history, because I think we can learn a lot from it.
And that's my big thing. Alright then. Jeff Beeler, David K. Brown, David Lyon, John Beeler and John Jordan are good sources. Those are quite good sources for looking at the Royal Navy, but honestly, D.K. Brown and me have an interesting conversation because my dad really, really didn't like him as a naval architect. He didn't think he was that good at all. So I sort of have those ones. He was a far better author than he was naval architect, let's put it this way. Jeff Beeler, do you have this one? The Sail and Steam Navy list, all the ships of the Royal Navy, 1815 to 1889 hardcover. Yes, I do have that one somewhere. I think it's over that one. Let's see if I can catch up. Oh, good lord. Didn't the IJA and IJN have a relationship that could best be described as full-on catfight or a knife fight in a phone box? I think those are worthy applications to describe it. Honestly, compared to their relationship, the Royal Navy and the RAF were bosom buddies. And frankly, they, you know, compared to the IJN and the IJA, the Royal Navy and the RAF were pretty much married in love compared to them. And we all know how fun the Royal Navy and the RAF's relationship is. It's usually jokey and slightly sarcastic at the best of times. But they do work together and they do have respect for each other's professionalism. In the IJN's case, there is nothing going on. The one interesting thing is in the video I'm doing, currently recording on the Japanese Navy. Sawdust, so we're back to good old cannon boat politics. Not really. No, naval presence is not about that sort of scenario. It's more about... Presence is about the relationships you can build up by being there. Presence is about having the knowledge and being able to turn up with minimal force so you don't have to turn up with maximum force. Ian Greenley, Nelson already carried 24-inch oxygen-enriched torpedoes, but the RN abandoned them. Only for the Japanese to create the long lance. Was the RN wrong? The RN abandoned them because they were quite so difficult to maintain. The Japanese were prepared to do what they did to maintain the long lance and to keep it in because they saw that as the edge. The Royal Navy preferred to have a slightly easier to maintain torpedo. Bitch on the President's mission seems to be the main mission of a joint Japanese maritime self-defense force. All the photos of those senior officers and ship commanders with those other, the others indicating, yeah, it pretty much, it's the presence is a major mission. Presence is about diplomatic military engagement. Presence is not about showing up to scare people. It's about showing up to make friends with people, and it's critical. And if you do not show up, you don't have a voice. So if you show up, you can have a voice with very minimal force, but you need to have the force actually there. And a frigate is a very good way of doing that, because it's a self-contained unit. So you're not too dependent upon anyone. Okay. Fun fact, every single British air-to-air kill since 1948 at least has been by the Royal Navy Fleet Air Arm. Yeah, it has been. It causes many arguments, that one. Ian Greenley, Vickers glass plate photos archives is a thing to behold. They took pictures of everything, and yeah, it is. It's beautiful. Turning 343. We've reached a 2-hour mark, and time for a few zips. There are lots of zips going for. I've got for only 5 cans here. Jeff Beeler, have you met Sharky Ward? If so, what is like? Sharky Ward is cool. I haven't met him in person. I have, though, had several Skype conversations with him over the years, including when I was doing my bachelor's research. And I can honestly say he sat there in his trunks on a hot tropical beach on the other side of a Skype call, while I was sitting in the UK in freezing cold. So he's cool, he's lovely, but he's also cruel in that way as well. Cruel. He's sitting there brilliantly tanned, happy as anything, his favourite tipple in front of him on a sunny beach, and there's me in, you know, cold in the UK. Alright. Here, some in a second. I'll be back in a second. I'll literally be back in a second. Sorry, that was my mum to correct me. We only have 6 litres of Iron Brew left in the house. 2 litres, one of the 2 litre bottles is hers. Okay. Jack Ray, I noticed quite a difference in your discussion style from your lecture, 80s videos, and now. You massively get way more fun to watch. What do you do to change that? Basically, most of the videos which I did were things which were recorded for YouTube, for Twitter, to be in 2-minute butts, or they're my presentations from university. So basically, these are me doing discussions, and then there are proper videos. So I didn't really sort of change much. It's just the discussions are me doing a seminar, and
that's what I think of them in my head when I think of how I'm going to approach it. I treat it as a seminar. When I am doing a video, it's me doing a lecture. So I try and make it as energetic as I can, but it's still a lecture.
Okay. Ian Greenley, presence or lack thereof, would a most pertinent example be to withdraw of HMS Endurance in 19-2? That is a classic example of the presence mission, what HMS Endurance does. So that is what we're talking about when we're talking about presence. Seem White, Japanese Navy is what I know. From British built Stonewall Jackson, ironclad to current. Ooh. That's just not doing anything. I was looking at this the other day. If you were to do away with Vanguard's crew accommodation in the midships and install a catapult plane, where would you stick lifeboats, or are you going to lose some... it's just not fun. And plus, you also have to remember with aircraft, if you have aircraft aboard and you have mid-launched aircraft and you have 5-inch guns, you can actually smash your own aircraft when you use your own guns. You have to be very careful when you're stowing the aircraft where you're going to put the guns. Ian Greenley, if you do join Discord, I'll be happy to answer the question, but I think I've lost the question that was originally about. Harger, biggest advantage of long lances is range. It really was a game changer for DD. It's no fun to have to fire them at ranges when capital ships can sink you if you miss. Yeah, that is the problem. Sheffy 42, take care, have fun. Hope to see you, probably see you on, maybe see you on Sunday, because I'm going to be doing another Q&A and book review on Sunday to partially make up for the poor start today. I do apologise for that. It was supposed to work. Jeff Beale, open question. What RN ships carry Royal Marines, and if they don't, do they have enhanced boarding parties like the RCN? Basically, every Royal Navy ship which looks like it's going to have to do boarding carries Royal Marines. That's the theory. In practice, there are most of the sailors that are also trained for boarding as well, to a lesser or a greater extent. But usually they carry Royal Marine boarding teams. And often those Royal Marine boarding teams go with sailors as backup. So, you know, it works out. Your mic, Juno 191, your mic is fixed, yahoo. Hopefully it's working. That's good. I'm not sure why it wasn't working, and I hope it's now better. I haven't done anything to it apart from stare at it. Vigilant, what does the RN have at Singapore, and what should they have for presence mission? What does the RN RAF have east of Suez?
Okay, so we have bases in Bahrain, and we are based in Bahrain in sort of Middle East. We have lots of equipment down there. We have a frigate currently based in Bahrain. And we have minesweepers and a supported minesweeper group based in the Gulf. We now have a base which we have upgraded again up to a similar level to that which we maintain at Bahrain in Singapore. So this is my point. I'm fairly sure we're getting ready to move to forward base a frigate probably in that region. If we were doing this in my ideal world, we would be building some more Batch 2 Rivers and some more Type 31s than we're currently building. And we'd be definitely looking at least having a Type 31 and a Batch 2 in the Falklands, a Type 31 Batch 2 sitting in the Gibraltar, Type 31 Batch 2 sitting in the Gulf, and a Type 31 and a Batch 2 sitting in Singapore. So we'd have at least those 8 forward deployed ships. We probably also have a Batch 2 sitting in the Caribbean. And that would be very much our forward presence. So we maintain them like we do our current forward presence. So if you have that many forward, you'd need that many aft to sort of supply the crew. So you'd be talking about, you need 8 Type 31s. You'd probably be needing at least 10 Batch 2s. So well, 10 OPVs. So you sort of, this is the sort of force I'm sort of talking about in terms of building up. So it is larger than what we're building now, but at the moment I think we're aiming for 5 31s or order with the potential of more. I think, as I said, I would be going for about 10, but that's me wanting to really maximize it. Juno 191, wait, have you got Discord now? Yes, there is a Discord. There is, it seems to be lighting up. There is a link somewhere in the chat. There's another link posted to the chat. Bitcherin, a fair bit in the Gulf. Eric Brown always came off as very nice and humble. Yes, Eric Brown was, though. Night Hair Reduction, are there any books on history behind Fleet Air Arm colour schemes and how they got to the colour scheme that post-war closely resembled early war USN colour schemes? There is. And I have it somewhere. Ah, yes. Oh. It's in this book by Ray Sturvian. Fleet Air Arm fixed wing aircraft since 1946 has it in. From memory. Yeah. It's colossal. It has all sorts of stuff in there. Ooh. 99 Iron Duke. Batch 2 OPVs are very underarmed. They're basically modern day sloops, so that's what I treat them as. Don't look at them as warships to fight a war like that. I'm thinking of them as escorts. Iskantab. Remember Marines manning turrets at Jutland? Yeah. It was what the Marines did aboard ships. They manned one of the turrets. They also provided the landing parties. So that was how they functioned in as a crew. Please click on the link and you can join the Discord discussion. It's pretty cool. There's a lot of people discussing stuff on the Discord. And I basically use it as a way to try and keep people updated with what's happening with the YouTube. I also put that out on the Patreon account, and sometimes to do some highlight some research I'm doing, and basically to try and keep up to date with how the account's doing in terms of the YouTube videos, if they're fulfilling your needs. Because I like to know that I'm giving you guys a nice good time on this channel and that you're enjoying it. Well, 99 Iron Duke, you might have worked out that 6 Type 45, 9 Type 26, and 10 Type 31 does equal 25. So, you know, there might be some method to my madness going on there. Oh. They might fund it, Stephanie Wilson. It's going to be a tough one, but actually, I think if you make the case that it's good for Global Britain and it's good for, which is one of their catchwords, and it's good for national industry, especially post-COVID-19 when the economy is having to recover, they might well go for it. And Nick Waters, they didn't retire free type, well, they...
They didn't quietly retire the last three Type 22s. They basically got rid of them because they said they were too expensive to maintain an individual class. I think the biggest thing I'm most annoyed about is selling of the three Type 23s to Chile. Because, honestly, to maintain 16 instead of 13 is not much more a cost. And not much more difficult. And it does help with things. It's like the cancelling of 7 and 8 of the Type 45s. If we'd had 8 Type 45s and 16 Type 23s, we'd have 24 escorts, and that would be a far bigger and easier to generate force than we currently have with the 19, which is in reality 17 and less once you take out the ones in bigger refit. I think Stephen White, reading Robert Fulton by, I came across British intelligence attempting to capture him in Long Island, but operation failed. Was it him trying to sell Napoleon and the French subtext? There are many reasons to capture Robert Fulton, but also in nicest way, sometimes I think his bio does talk things up a bit. Jeff Beeler, we talk HMS Leander 1848 and naval museums on Discord. We do. That is quite a fun discussion going on. And the fact we've now found out so much about her, which wasn't known by people. I've now actually sent some print screens back, some of those screenshots back to my archivist friends, and they're going, what? It's there? It's quite funny. Jeff Beeler, we need a book report channel on Discord. We can do that. I think I can do that, actually, on Discord, can't I? I think I can set up a book report thing. Voice channels plus text channel. Book. There you go. There's a book channel now set up on the Discord. Blue Ship Butter, we are indeed enjoying this. Well, thank you, that's good. Okay. 900, Dust Clark, yes, I know you're one of the good chaps on the Royal Navy. I try my best to help the Royal Navy out, and I try my best to do the work with them, because I think the Royal Navy has the trouble when it comes to selling itself, because it happens so often so far beyond what people are seeing on the news and daily. It's very hard to make the case for something in this very, very busy world we're in unless you see it happening right in front of you, because you see the things right in front of you and they're important. They're obviously important and they're right in front of you. So it's far more difficult to make the case for something so far away. June 9, 1991. If you had to bring back tribals, what modifications would you make to them? I was bringing them back now. Well, I'm probably adding Sea Scepter and Radar and all sorts of things like that. If I was in 1936 and I was building the Tribals then, I would have gone for the more expensive mount, which could get the guns, the turrets up to 80 degree, up to about 75 degrees. They had an option of one which would take them all the way up to 80. They had to take the governor off them and it wasn't supported, but they could get on some turrets higher up. But I would have actually put it in them, the mount, so they could do it. And I would have probably gone, fuck this, excuse the French, and have made them slightly longer and slightly broader, even though that would have made them slightly heavier, so that they could better protect their engines, so they'd be less prone to turbinitis. Because the reason they got turbinitis was because the turbines were getting shook so much by the force of the water, the hitting the hull, because of the way they're mounted on the hull. So if you actually make the hull slightly longer, slightly bigger, you actually remove the stress, reduce the stress hitting the engines, and you can build in more cushioning so that the engines get less affected by the damage of the water, basically. Yeah, Naval Museums channel would be quite cool. I will add that in as well.
I'm going to actually put it as Navy Museums and Places to Visit. There you go.
Welcome to all the Discord people, by the way. It's nice to have people there. Ingrid, I was a little surprised the Iron didn't buy up the three Bung Tomo Corvettes. Honestly, the RN doesn't like having small classes. It likes to have large classes, because if you have more ships of one class, they might be individually less capable in certain aspects than the ships of another class, or you could have a small number, but you can generate more. If you've got three of something, you can usually generate one of it. If you've got six, you can more often than not generate three of it. Sarkhan, sadly all my books are on ships and Navy stuff are in German. Hey, still post them. I can't read, but I can always get my girlfriend to translate them. Hopefully she's not... possibly she's still watching this, so... Love you. No, she is absolutely super bright when it comes to languages. She is an amazing historian and she's an amazing linguist, so... You know. Stephanie Wilson, as some of the people here are probably literate in German. Yeah, fair number are. Jeff Beeler, the modern tribals would look like stretched type 45, I think. If I was building a modern tribal class design, oh, it would be a stretched type 45. It would probably have two guns on the front. I would probably want to double 5 inches on the front if I could, and two of them, because I like my guns. I'd probably have a VLS system. I might well have it built like a battle class, so the VLS, so the guns are superimposed, and then the sort of the superstructure, which is the secondary super firing mount, is on, turns into a VLS, which sort of, you know, wraps around into the rest of the wraps down into the rest of the hull and builds up into the superstructure. Ooh, it'd be cute. It'd be a good looking ship. It would have three phalanx and three 40mm mounts on it as its firepower to defend it, plus the two big guns and the VLS and the helicopters. It'd be good. But that's me going definitely full on bilge pumps. Baron Furness, who built many of our nuclear subs, was hoping to get HMS Dreadnought as a museum ship in the future. That would be good. I think Baron Furness should get some more museum ships. I think we should do more to spread out the Navy museums. I think it's going to be difficult to get a nuclear submarine and turn it into a museum, but I think it should be done. I just hope they don't do what they did with the German submarine on the Wirral side of the Mersey, which is the cut in half. Which I feel is rather cruel, but you know, I can understand why it is. It does make it a far easier to get in and look around it, but... I was listening to a book about Bismarck, Audible, and Lutschitz requested that Scharnhorst get the same hangar that Neisenhower had. I knew that both had three spotting planes, didn't know the difference. Yeah, one has more space and is far more secure for shipping after post a refit than the other one. Basic is how to protect it. Jeff Beale, it helps the Type 26 that the Aussies and especially the Canadians are building so many too. Yes, it does, but it's another reason why I think the Royal Navy should get another one. I think 9 works out, because remember, it's the rule of 3, the Stardust, but also 9 does give you a bit more of a freedom of operation than 8. It's going to sound, it sounds really silly and going 8 versus 9, it's only one ship difference. It has a big impact long term. Nick Waters, Jeff Beeler, besides hull shape and engines, I bet they'll end up really different. Not actually as different. There's a lot of work going on to keep them common, from what I understand. There's a lot of work. Vision, I like the idea. Shekna is a complete Type 7 submarine in Labu Kiel in Northern Germany, next to Navy Memorial. Very cramped. They are. Incredibly cramped. Frosty, can you make your lectures converted into podcasts? Well, I'm doing a podcast series with called Bilge Pumps with Drac and Armored Carriers, so there are going to be some podcasts coming out soon. Furikin, we could do some good camel do with some good camel laird built ships at Wirral. Pity NDHC sold the bloody I know, but camel laird is still building ships and they're still good, so we'll see. Juno 109, why do most destroyers today go away from the dual mounted 5-inch gun turrets?
Because of complexity. Basically, a dual turret is complicated. It's far easier to have a single turret. You've got far more space inside to get to the mechanism and do maintenance. And it's far less complicated.
Right. 60 Zetel sub, the Dutch Royal... Oh, cool. There is also... There is HMS Oberon, isn't it? Sitting in next door to HMS Cavalier in Chatham Docks. And there's one in Submarine Museum.
Right then, I've now just realised the time. It has gone on quite late and I haven't had any food. So I'm going to say have a nice evening and thank you very much. As always, please subscribe, please share, please, you know, chat away, because I like having you chatting. I like having as many people as I can, because that just increases the chatting. And thank you very much for taking part. Sorry again about the issues at the beginning. And thank you very much. And thank you as ever to my patrons. They're very, very nice. I have just seen the amount I'm supposed to be getting every month at the moment. And it's very, very kind of them. It's, as I said, everything goes towards funding research and doing it more. So thank you. Thank you very much.
Food time. Definitely food time. Take care and thank you.